Hello, and welcome to Family Matters. I'm Dr. Mariana Martinez, your host. As predicted by the U.S. Census Bureau, by the year 2030, 20% of the population in the United States will be 60 years and older, compared to the 13% we have today. In less than 30 years, there will be 19 million adults 85 and older in this country, compared to the 5.5 million we have today. Aging has been part of the human experience, but there appears to be a huge variance in the way people deal with this stage of life. Joining me to explore the issue of aging and late life adaptation is Dr. Kerr Barone. Dr. Barone has practiced as a licensed professional counselor since 2000. She earned her PhD in counseling from the George Washington University in Washington, D.C. Currently, she's in private practice and on the faculty of the Bowen Center for the Study of the Family, and she's also an adjunct faculty member in the Department of Counseling and Human Development at the George Washington University here in Washington, D.C. Kerr, welcome to Family Matters.
Hi, welcome. Thank you.
So, Kerr, you have been thinking about this topic for a while. In fact, your dissertation was focused on aging. Tell us about that project.
Well, I was very interested in aging and specifically interested in aging well in late life. I was helping TA a class for one of my mentors, and the class was on adaptation. And when we got to the period or development in life that was about late life, I just was very curious and motivated in this topic. And one of the reasons was that most of the literature and research that is out there is on not aging well. It's on Alzheimer's, dementia, even caretakers having a difficult time taking care of an older adult. And so I really wanted to figure out, I had a sense and a great, you know, a lot of thought that some people must be able to do this well and still have hope and find some sort of meaning and purpose in life. And so I began studying Eric Erickson's papers on late life that spoke about ethical identity, that spoke about spiritual development in late life and the great need for individuals to stay connected with their family members and their friends and in the community. And this would prepare them for a better adaptation, for a successful adaptation, and for, you know, an end of life that is still joyous and that they can still have some sort of future forward thinking. And that's what's really important.
I'm really interested in this topic. I had two, now they passed away, but I had two grandmothers. One got to be 80, I think, 95, and the other one 99. Mm-hmm. So I'm here for a while, I think. So I need to learn something about this conversation and how to age well, because I can relate to that idea that there are ways of doing this.
Sure.
And that one can go down the path of the despair and the difficulties and all the you know, problems that come with aging.
Sure.
Or with that, you can also have a different perspective in life. Now, what were the things that you discovered in your dissertation that were most significant? You talked already about some, but tell us more about what was significant in making this difference.
Well, I think it's important to know what happens in late life that are some of the challenges that people are up against in this area. And so it's difficult to find a purpose and a meaning in life when a lot of things are changing. There's many transitions that are going on. Even just if you think about within the family system, the individual may have lost a spouse, and so there's death and loss there and grieving. And there might even be a loss of a role of being a wife or a husband that was once comforting. In addition to that, which is a big one for most people, and I think I already think about this, is what do we do when we retire? You know, I love my practice. I'm very passionate about what I do and what I, you know, when I work with individuals and help them. And what will that mean for me when I can no longer, you know, practice that and find meaning? So I think transitioning out of work, you know, leaves individuals for a lot of time on their hands, and maybe they feel very disconnected from the community, and they can feel disconnected from their friends and even family members because they're at home, maybe sitting for 8 hours and finding things to do. So I think there are some many challenges in late life. In addition to that, it's very hard to be hopeful or to look in the future when you know that there is an impending death. We don't live forever. And there's what we call a death anxiety, and individuals most believe, and Eric Erickson talks about this, and Freud and other fathers of psychology, that we are born with what's called death anxiety. And this death anxiety goes into the unconscious, but in late life, it begins to arise. It comes to the fore. And so you're then faced with this higher level of anxiety. So you still have the anxiety that's going on in the world. You still have the anxiety from your family, from your changing job. You might even have financial anxiety, but then up comes this new one.
So the truth comes to be
right.
More palpable.
The truth comes to light. So I think for the adults that I spoke with, they were upfront about having this death anxiety. They could actually talk about it. They were prepared. They had the facts and the patterns of, you know, what to expect when they did die. They might have gone through their will. They might have thought out where they would live, et cetera, et cetera. So they're confronting the death anxiety. It's not easy. It's not pretty, but it's there. And in addition to that, they had some sort of passion, motivation, and curiosity in something. For example, one gentleman that I spoke with took a liking to taking his grandson fishing. That was very important for him. And so this gave him purpose and meaning in life. It gave him something to look forward to. And for many adults, grandparenting is the best opportunity to give back and to make meaning in your life, because you're really serving two generations. You're serving your grandchild, mm-hmm. and you're serving, you know, your children. And so, and
actually,
this,
because yourself, you're
and
serving
yourself. That's right. And then you're serving self, because, and I'm glad you mentioned that. And this continues to go on. You know, after you are dead and gone, you still your presence is living with your grandchild and your child. Mm-hmm. And you're right. Focusing on self was an important aspect of many of the older adults that I spoke with that were considered having successfully adapted to late life. They could focus on self. They had an understanding of what they were interested in. They had an understanding of their values. And most of them, and this is in more research than mine, that older adults value relationships that are within the family. And the reason that they give this, you know, such a higher level of importance is that they feel that relationships in late life with your family are more important than, you know, just social relationships like the book club or at the coffee shop.
Which are important, but
they're very important. But older adults tend to go towards relationships that are very meaningful, that they feel will somehow leave a footprint behind for them when they are gone. And so I think that I met some adults and worked with some adults that would learn something new that they were able to do, like Tai Chi or yoga.
Wow.
They started this in later life, learned that this was a way for them to learn about self, stay within self, focus on their own body, focus on their breathing, also begin to learn about self. And then most of them that I spoke with would have an interest of wanting to teach others. So they wanted to share this. And so this was a way of imparting their wisdom. And older adults are at a greater advantage for having wisdom. And this was another variable that I found in my research. And they were able to learn from past experiences and have an ability and a desire to want to share that learning and experiences with others. And this was as a means to promote growth and growth
in
and development
and
in self and in others.
Let me ask you something. Did you find that these efforts to be connected with family, to stay focused on self, to have meaningful activities, to learn something new and practice something new in their lives and be passionate about something, mm-hmm. did that come from sort of an effort of will, or was it something that happened? Mm-hmm. How much effort did you find was needed in these process of aging well?
I think that's a great question. I think it takes great effort. I really do. I think these individuals really worked hard at really defining themselves in the world in a new way, and defining themselves, their self in the family. So are they going to choose to take on the grandparenting role? Is it okay to let go of some of that parenting role that existed there, to let go of some of the areas that they were experts in before? and change and switch over to a different role and a different expert. I think most would say being a grandparent is a little bit different than being a parent. You know, some grandparents will report that they actually love it because they can go and have fun and do activities, but then they get to drop the child off. Mm-hmm. And so there might even be less discipline or less control involved. But either way, it's a different way or a different perspective to look at your family, and it's a just different way to approach your relationships. And I think that when we do stay involved in relationships, that is where the self develops, that is where we learn about self. You know, existing on a desert island is a difficult way to learn about self. We don't know the interaction that goes on.
If you think about somebody aging and being alone in an apartment or even in a nursing home, but you know, not having meaningful relationships there, it's like living in an island.
Yes, you're right. And the individuals who were able to make, you know, the best out of what they had. So once again, in late life, you're dealing with some physical ailments. You know, you're beginning to lose things that you were able to do. Maybe you ran, or maybe you did a hardcore exercise to get rid of some of the anxiety. Well, in aging, you might have knee problems, you might have other problems, so you have to give up this exercise. And the adults that I spoke with that were able, once again, to be flexible, to be able to find interest in other areas like Tai Chi and yoga. Some women found, or even men found, a great interest in gardening, that they felt that this was really, you know, putting their hands in the earth was really a way to give back and to be a part of, you know, the world and the community again. So really just finding ways to get back into the world after you're not working, you're maybe have lost touch with your family because they're very busy and doing a lot of activities. So I think it's a lot of work and a lot of very purposeful behavior. But then I think that behavior only comes about with a certain level of wisdom. And when I mean that, I mean a certain way of having a cognitive thought process involved. That means that there's some sort of reality that one has about their situation, that they're staying real and that they're staying in tune to what's going on with them.
So there needs to be a process of thinking about mm-hmm. this. It doesn't happen just, or maybe for some people, but usually it doesn't happen just like a flow. You really have to make some decisions with purpose, with an idea of what is reality, what can I do, what I cannot do anymore, what others need or don't need, and so forth. So it really requires sitting down and thinking and planning and as you say, this effort of developing some wisdom too.
Yes, and I think the thinking and planning and that clear thought that comes with that takes quite a bit of effort, and you really do need to be attuned to self, to your own emotions and feelings about aging and what's going on with you. And then in addition to that, to the thought process that's involved. So being able to identify the difference between your emotions, your feelings of loss and grieving, and then also thoughts of, but I'm still here, you know, these positive thoughts versus the negative thoughts. And really being able to come up with more positive thinking to rule out the negative thinking. I think in late life, you're up against some of the most negative thought that can be out there. And some of it comes from society, that, you know, older adults cannot do certain things, that they're not as useful as the young and the beautiful, youthful individuals. And so I think aging successfully takes much effort, and it takes a very strong ego or a strong self, a soul, mm-hmm. to do that. And I think that comes from really knowing your values and your interests and really taking on certain projects, maybe even being creative and finding ways to give back to the community, to give back to your family, such as the grandparenting role, are really important.
And I'm sure that it has a timing as well. If you start in that spiral that goes down, it's very difficult to really regain that energy to go to the places you're describing with the passion, with the connections. So it is a time where one needs to be very aware of how one handles, you know, self.
Yes.
Because once you get into the despair path, mm-hmm. it's a hard way back.
Yes, you're right. Once the despair begins, I think that you can really fall into that, especially with if you have friends that are, you know, dying around you, if you have a loss of a spouse.
Mm-hmm. Siblings that are dying as mm-hmm. well.
You might Siblings, be... absolutely. And the family. Mm-hmm. I mean, I think it gives one a great opportunity to, really find a self and find what you're interested in and be able to translate that in a very meaningful way. Older adults more than other developmental life stages, have more time to self. And studies do show that they spend more time, in their inner thoughts. They are okay with, a lot of older adults are okay with sitting several hours a day and closing their eyes and just thinking and resting and being in touch with, what they're thinking and what their thoughts are. And most of these individuals, report this kind of calmness that they have when they're able to do that. But then it takes effort outside of that to really act upon these thoughts that you're having. And I think that's what can be so difficult for older adults, and maybe
engaging.
It's difficult in moving, yes, engaging with others, getting out there. Mm-hmm. Some older adults that I know are very, became very politically, charged in the community. Maybe they retired and they really took a strong interest in politics. And I think this can too, I have seen, can be a great way for the individuals to really get back into the community and be a part of the community. And I think the importance there is to also still remain in touch with your family and with your grandchildren and your children too. So still creating a space for that.
Did you see a difference between those older adults that were connected to the family and those that were very well connected to the community but not to the family? Like the family being an element there that can distinguish?
I didn't quite get that into that detailed of variables in my research, but I have seen studies that it seems like now that it is comparable, that the interactions in the family and in the community are showing the same results for successful adaptation. But I think the interaction in the community had to be very intense and very regular to equal out the interactions in the family. So a lot of it in the community is like church community. Mm-hmm. So a very close, intense spiritual connection would somehow equal out the family relationship. But from my point of view and being a family therapist, I truly feel and think that there is a more important connection within the family. Our first interactions with our parents and our siblings are those first interactions where we begin to create self and where we are developing. And so I think it is only natural for that to cycle back through, and as an older adult, to have some family members available to you.
I'm thinking also that this older individual has the viewpoint of two generations above them, meaning parents and usually grandparents, or in some way you're in touch with these two generations above you, and then two generations under you. Mm-hmm. So you have a viewpoint of 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 generations.
Yeah, it's really a beautiful view. And I do, when I work with individuals who are having issues or challenges in their family, maybe they are a baby boomer, someone in their 50s or late 40s, and are dealing with an aging parent. A lot of times what I will ask them is to go to the aging parent and ask them about the history of the family. What was it like for other aging adults in that family? What did it look like? What role did they take? Did they go to a nursing home necessarily? Did they stay in the family? Did they move in with a grandchild or a younger person? Did they take care of, their grandchildren? Was that the role that they took on? So I always encourage individuals who are dealing with older adults in their family to go to them and talk with them about what that looked like in the family. And I think you're right, that gives you the opportunity, or this person the opportunity, to figure out what it might look like for them in the future.
And look back, and then you'll see to the future. That's very
right.
True. I have a paternal grand aunt, and she has no children, but she devoted last year to make this little booklet about the story of my paternal family. And she went back, I don't know how many generations, with pictures and dates and important events and so forth. And she gave one of these books to each, siblings, but also the next generation and my children. So three generations have this information. Mm-hmm. And I think just knowing that has been very important for many of us. And I'm sure for her, this project was significant.
Yes, that's what I would be curious about. What did that project mean to her? I mean, it seems like she really wanted to leave something behind that was, had her mark on it. And also to give to the family. I mean, I wonder, she must have thought that it was important for, you and your other individuals in the family to know this information and to have the facts correct from her perspective. It sounds like she took on that opportunity to really show some wisdom, to show some thought, to be reflective about the family, to look at it from different perspectives and to report what she saw. And then also in wisdom, there's also this level of having compassion for others. And I think that when you have wisdom, you have a nice balance of these three areas of cognitive realistic thinking, of reflective thought, being able to put yourself in others' shoes and think from different perspectives, and also a compassion to want to promote growth and human development in others. And so this sounds like it was a great project for her to be able to put that forth in the family and to give to others.
Yeah, I cannot say how much of a factor this was, but she mm-hmm. is 85 and she just recovered from a hip replacement. And she's doing beautifully. So I wonder how much energy she's getting from a project like this, among other things that she does, but mm-hmm. Just connecting to the past and the future mm-hmm. in a meaningful way seems to be helpful for her. I don't know for everybody, but...
Yeah, I think it's important for older adults if they want to revisit family history or if they want to revisit the family timeline, that is a way of getting those facts in their head. That is a way of them getting clear on, you know, what is going on in their life. And so they may want to revisit the past and the middle and the current to maybe deal with anxieties that they're having about where they are in their life development period. So I think it's important when I work with families who are dealing with older adults or even older adults, to allow them to discuss these, you know, historical pieces, but then also to allow them to be frank about, you know, their future thinking. You know, how do they feel, or what are their thoughts about dying? Are they having a lot of feelings of anxiety and fear of not knowing the unknown, or are they becoming at peace with that, or do they just refuse to talk about it at all? So I think as family members, we can also begin to promote and support our older adults that are in the family for successfully aging.
In your experience, does the old adult, however you can describe this older person, do they think that the younger generations are not interested in their experience and their history? Mm-hmm. Or do they know how important it is for the next generation to know?
I think that depends. Like you said in the beginning, individuals just vary on how they age in late life. And some of this can be mostly attributed to maybe how they did in their earlier developmental years. Some of this gets carried on into late life. So if you've learned some poor coping skills, or if you've learned, sadness and depression, if you've been practicing that for a while, unfortunately, that becomes a little more set into place when aging occurs, because you're taxed, you have a higher level of anxiety. And then there are others who have positive coping skills, have, you know, done that and created that throughout their lives and have still continued to pull together the positive coping skills that they've used to, you know, successfully age. And some of these coping skills are, you know, knowing how to release anxiety, you know, maybe through leisure activities, knowing how to connect with a spouse or a family member that is important to you, and being, being in a positive parenting situation. These are all ways that individuals can cope positively with other issues that arise in early developmental stages.
But what hope is there then for mm-hmm. people who have not having the best of mm-hmm. life functioning all along, and they sure. arrive to this life stage and they... Is there a way to overcome some of those difficulties, or is that past sort of it's going to be another version of the past?
Sure. Well, developmentally, I believe that individuals grow and develop until death. And that's been, you know, somewhat debatable in psychology. Some psychologists just in development at a certain age and don't believe that it continues. But Eric Erickson believed that and continued until death. And so I think that what you just explained, not having hope, maybe, you know, you had a difficult time earlier in life and things aren't just getting better, and now late life is surely to be worse. I think people do get caught up in that, but there still is hope to learn new coping skills and to have new ideas creativity and a motivation to reach out. It might be in late life an opportunity for one to finally reconnect as a grandparent and maybe do the things that they felt they couldn't do as a parent, to relive that, maybe to decrease some of the regret. The regretful thoughts that they had. So I think that there are still opportunities in late life to grow and to develop. And I think the growing and developing does come from communications with others, from the relationships that are formed, from taking care of self and thinking about what's better for my growth and development, as well as, you know, giving to others and promoting that in them.
Yeah, I bet that with Bowen Theory and the ideas in Bowen Theory that are part of one of the major ideas is how to define yourself.
Yes.
And how to think about you and how you present yourself to others. That can give an opportunity for people to
Sure.
position themselves differently, maybe for the first time in their lives. They can have the freedom or the capacity
Yes.
to do something different with a child, with a grandchild, or with somebody in the community.
Yes, and Mariana, that just reminds me, you know, sometimes in working with the families, and maybe they're having a difficult time deciding, you know, how to deal with an aging aunt. Let's say maybe she's living in a house and maybe another older adult in the family lived with her and that older adult died. So now you have an aunt who has, you know, ailing health in this family home that does not want to leave. Mm-hmm. And it's so important for the family members who do come in that are, you know, beginning to make these decisions to think about, you know, who does make the decisions in the family. So really step back, and it gives you an opportunity to figure out who makes the decisions in the family, you know, who is there, who isn't there, what are the facts about what's going on with this aunt, what is the reality of her living there by herself. You can also even assess her functioning. You know, what does she want? Is she truly able to live there or not? Are people just emotionally reacting to this?
I guess, Kerr, that can be a whole new topic, and I'll invite you again, I promise, to talk about how to promote the best for the older adult mm-hmm. and when you're in charge as a new generation.
Sure.
Thank you for participating today.
Thank you, Mariana.
In Family Matters.
Thank you.
I would like to remind you that the Bowen Center for the Study of the Family offers the community affordable psychotherapy in both English and Spanish. If you would like more information about our topic or the services at the Bowen Center, please visit the website at www.thebowencenter.org or send me an email at familymatters@thebowencenter.org. You can also find us on Facebook or call 202-965-4400. Thank you for watching, and I invite you to join me again for another edition of Family Matters. I'm Dr. Mariana Martinez, and your family does matter.